Stay tuned. In the next 55, we have Clive Robertson, ABC Radio, this time phenomenon of the microscope. You'll see him at work in the 2BL studios. You'll see one of his famous exchanges with Caroline Jones. You'll hear the opinions of his commercial competitors, Gary O'Callaghan, Bob Rogers, Ian McRae. Clive Robertson, unique, individual, perhaps eccentric. Tonight we go behind the button-down mind of Clive Robertson.
The last audience rating period for the year ends tomorrow, and to mark the occasion, take a look at one of the ABC great rating successes, Clive Robertson. Here's Kel Richards.
Every week, almost 500,000 Sydneysiders tune into the 2BL breakfast session with Clive Robertson. They are the people on the receiving end of the strange amalgam served up by the remarkable Robertson. For 2 years, I had a more intimate association. Twice each morning, I joined him to talk about AM and to parry wits, as it were. Over a great many breakfasts at the old Greasy Spoon Cafe, Clive and I have discussed his radio program often, and just exactly what it is he does that people so enjoy. And that is what this report is all about. 5 o'clock in the morning, and the city belongs to the stray dogs, the street sweepers, and the shift workers. The office cleaners are emptying waste paper baskets and sweeping corridors.
Good morning. Isn't it funny? The stupid record has got the wrong track on it. I was meant to play Waltzing Matilda, and here it is. Terrific.
Once a jolly swagman stopped by a billy bar. Under the shade.
12 of Sydney's 15 radio stations are already on the air, pouring their load of music and chat and caffeine-supported cheerfulness over the quiet grey city. In this desert of rock and roll and toothpaste commercials, there is an oasis. There is Robertson.
It's 12 minutes past five. This is an album of Dinah Shore when she could sing. It sort of summarises Monday morning. Imagine waking up, your wife having had the umpteenth headache, and you're wondering what it's all about as you search for your little cache of Playboys, for your excitement for the day. And you open the window, and you've got a hangover. Imagine the feeling.
The 33 years old former steam train coal shoveler, apprentice electrical fitter, and fondler of naked ladies. Clive Robertson is something of a cult figure, famous for his witty barbs aimed at such diverse targets as drivers of valiance, boring singers, foif annoying disc jockeys, ABC executives, and people who wear safari suits.
Selection here of about 30, and they expect us to find the right one. And there's no numbers. If they produced a encyclopedia upstairs, they wouldn't produce an index. I bet you it's the last one I come to. Well, of course, Reg, because once you'd come to it, you wouldn't keep looking, would you?
No, Reg.
The forecast has been brought in by Mr. Dunsmore, a well-known group of people frighteners. There are no warnings out. New South Wales, isolated thunderstorms in the northeast corner. Cloudy periods and a few showers on the coast, chiefly northwards, dry inland, mild to warm and mostly sunny. West of the Divide, early fog patches inland, light to moderate south to southeast winds, sea slight on a low swell. Metropolitan forecast is a mild day with cloudy periods, chance of a coastal shower, light to moderate south to southeast winds, sea slight a low swell. Yes, 21 degrees for Sydney and Liverpool 23 in brief cloudy periods, which seems to indicate perspiration. Or glowing, I think, is what women do. The twilight. What's wrong with the way I live,
the way I use my time? As Sydney's alarm clocks attack the nerves of the city's sleepers, Robertson rumbles on, sounding very much the way people feel as they fall out of bed and stumble off to work. A stark contrast to the chirpy, cheerful chatter of his commercial competitors. Producer Tony Twiss makes coffee and cornflakes, while Robertson composes a verbal fantasia based on the imagined private lives of anyone within earshot.
Oh, it's finished. What's wrong with the way I live? Nothing actually wrong with the way I live, except I'm losing my hearing. It's true what they say. I was going to learn to fly once. But it's very expensive to learn to fly. I'd like to fly over a brief beach. It's so crowded, the airways just above that. Helicopters, things like that. Have a good look. You know, you could dive bomb them with underwear, couldn't you? It'd frighten the pants off them. I don't think that was quite correct, actually. It's 7:30. It's Lost in Love.
And you don't count for much, but I'm not letting go. I believe there's too much to believe. So lift your eyes if you feel you can. Reach for a star and I'll show you a plan. I'd figured it out, what I needed was someone to show me.
In 1,000 cruising Kingswoods, disgruntled morning motorists tune in to a Clive Robertson who is no more gruntled than they are. The records are mere interruptions in a rambling flow of patter that is as existential as Jean-Paul Sartre, only funnier. The morning ticks on. The adrenaline slowly pumps into the city's arteries.
Lost in Love, Air Supply, group of blokes. A little bit worrying occasionally. That sort of falsetto, but still, one day it might. It's 7:18.
Can't you hear me calling Caroline?
Hello, my dear. How are you?
Clive Robertson is joined by Caroline Jones for a daily joust that mirrors the actual breakfast table tensions in many listening households.
No. Also
sounds a bit tired, really, yes.
Yes, he's had a few problems with the pacemaker.
We're talking this morning about the possibility of another truckies strike. You possibly remember what happened on Razorback Mountains.
John Laws, where are you?
No, I think it has anything to do with him.
I'll fly down and solve the problem.
No, I don't think it has anything to do with him this time. No.
Didn't last time, I don't think.
Then we'll meet Dr. Graham Webb, stumbled upon a new type of crocodile.
Isn't he at Tattletavern anymore?
No, no, he's in Arnhem Land, and he's a herpetologist. For which I understand there is a cure. I think so.
Sorry, I beat you there.
But he has. You always do, don't you?
Yes, definitely.
He went looking for something else.
Yes.
On an expedition, do you see?
Yes.
And he found pygmy crocodiles.
What do you mean?
Pygmy? He found a new... Would it be a race or a breed of crocodile? A clutch of crocodiles, perhaps.
Yes.
A bag of crocodiles.
A very delicate clutch of them.
Anyhow, he found them. He stumbled upon them. Pygmy crocodiles, which no one knew existed.
How big are these?
Are you enjoying your coffee?
It's a bit off this morning. I think Tony's put too much bromide in.
You understand, don't you, that people can hear on the air if you're eating or drinking?
Can they?
Mm-hmm.
This is terrific. This is a whole new phase of my relationship with my listener. How big are these, he said, asking, how big are these little crocodiles?
It just seems better for me to refer you to the broadcasting regulations than someone in the hierarchy.
I heard your program yesterday.
They have more clout.
And I rang him with a question and he didn't use it.
Page 52, paragraph 2,
3B1. How are you, Reg? How's the... It's settling, you know. Getting out of the lads. A few problems here, a few of them there. Just watch out for them. Yes, don't wear anything too flashy. Keep the trousers loose. You finished?
And we have an early close today for Parliament at 10:28. Look, in Camera Craft, the current edition, October 1979, there are the most magnificent photographs taken by you.
That's funny.
I have no idea. You're a brilliant photographer.
That's funny. I was
you?
In the September issue as well.
Well, you're in the October one here.
Does it say October?
Clive, seriously, just for once, they are magnificent.
Are they?
Mm.
Yes. It's amazing how the soft comes through so well in that photograph on page 3.
That must have been a September issue, just a minute.
You like the way I said a lot of blokes are like that. Oh, he's talking about soft. Oh, I like it when he talks dirty.
Now, there's one of clothes pegs, and there's a beautiful one of a ferry on Sydney Harbour.
South Stain.
Is
that's
it?
The best picture of the South Stain
it's
ever taken.
Glorious.
It's amazing. It's copyright, too.
But the mist on the bridge
mist
behind.
Mist on the bridge behind. It's gorgeous.
What about the old man sitting
old
at
man
his
table? Sitting at the table. What? I don't know what you're talking about, you know.
Oh, well, other people will if they read Camera Craft.
How big are these little? How big are these little crocodiles?
No.
How big are these?
Perhaps it would have been a good idea because You seem to have perhaps even more competence as a photographer than you do as a broadcaster. Not that one would wish to cast any aspersions.
I'm finished this program.
Shall I give you the time?
You never have you?
27
you keep
and
threatening
a half
it and nothing happens. Your lips say yes, but your eyes say no.
27 and a half past.
Okay, right. Good. Would you like to introduce this song from Anne Murray?
I'd love to if I had any idea what it was.
Good. Right. See you later. 27 and a half past seven.
Bye now.
Ta-da, wonderful.
Every night I sit here by my window.
Meanwhile, down the road, the disc jockeys who keep chucking out all those commercials have a high regard for the eccentric abilities of Mr. Robertson. For example, Gary O'Callaghan, who for 23 years has had breakfast every weekday morning with a couple of 100,000 2UE listeners and one talkative sparrow. He describes Clive Robertson in these terms.
A wit, cynical, and I guess probably the youngest eccentric I've ever met. He and Dick Smith, as far as I'm concerned, would be the great double in life.
They say that the idiosyncrasies of youth become the eccentricities of middle age. You think that he's getting there early, do you?
No, I think he just started off on a high note. Maybe he's going to be worse. he's a great character, though. He really is a character.
How do you rate Clive Robertson as a communicator?
A good communicator, and that can be borne out by the survey results.
A listener will at times dislike something he's discussing, and suddenly he'll throw a little switch and put a funny tag to it, which was the whole part of his dissertation anyway, and make you laugh. I think he's brilliant. I think he's bordering on a genius. And I think he's, because of that, personally, something of an eccentric and very difficult to know.
Bob Rogers has been in radio for 37 and a half years, for the past six of which he's been a fan of Robertson.
The first impression I had was like a breath of fresh air. It was so different, so brilliant. Not always brilliant, but mostly, at times, quite brilliant. And to use a hackneyed word of the industry, unpredictable. I don't like using the word because they use that for tonight shows. They always say, the unpredictable. Like Walsh Show, the unpredictable, what will happen next? It's predictable in actual fact. But Clive is, because you never really know what he's going to say next.
For the past 10 years, Ian McRae has been the jokey breakfast comic on 2SM.
Have you managed to catch any of Clive's work?
Yes, well, this is true. Probably a little bit coming in some mornings because Clive starts half an hour before me. So I can actually get quite a good deal of material for my show on the way into work. So
right.
It's going cheap, isn't it? Yes.
Okay, then you've heard a bit of Clive. What do you think of his work?
Oh, I mean, I can't. I'm not going to answer that. I mean, if I said here and now I thought it was really unprofessional and loose and
you're getting close.
Really off,
that's right.
I would be pretty close, but no, not really. I think it's a refreshing approach.
Yes, I don't use a joke book.
I wish he could move into radio.
It seems to me that both of you are a lot more than just announcers. I mean, there are a lot of people with nice voices who tell the time and play records. So how do you define yourselves? Would you define an announcer or a humorist or a comedian or what?
There's always been a discussion about what the hell we are. Announcer's very pompous, is that word again? A personality is pretentious.
That's right.
A disc jockey is not what we are into, really.
No.
I don't know. Someone said communicator, even that sounds a bit heavy, doesn't it?
I don't know. Yeah.
But how do you define yourself, what you're doing?
I don't know. You know, I have no idea what I am at all. I'm substantially the same as when I was four, which mentally, in some respects, not very long ago. And I don't know. I have no self-image. I don't have a mirror to look at. I don't know.
A lady wrote...
So, Clive Robertson himself doesn't know exactly what it is he does on the air, but clearly he is much more than a mere announcer. While to call him a disc jockey or a comedian sounds like an insult.
I lie about other things as well.
In fact, he is a humorist in the great tradition of such sceptical and witty commentators on the world as S.J. Perelman, Robert Benchley, Dorothy Parker, James Thurber, or James Chesterton. It has been said that S.J. Perelman's humour was inspired by a fastidious disdain for the fake, the tawdry, the pompous. And the same can be said of Robertson.
I suppose I should put another record on, shouldn't I?
Humorists are people who never resort to merely composing jokes. They have the gift for looking at the familiar in an unfamiliar way, for seeing life in an undistorting mirror.
He's got such a brilliant conceptual mind. I think you made a distinction that he's not a comedian, he's a humorist. There's so much deeper than just that clever twist that he puts to something. It's the way he looks at so many situations.
Thank you. Still haven't got him house trained.
And so, to the list of great Australian humorists, Lenny Lower, Alexander MacDonald, Ross Campbell, Ron Saw, Philip Adams and the rest, must be added the name of Clive Robertson.
When ladies go out with Prince Charles, they have to call him Sir. I think that's terrific. To call him Sir, I mean, that would sort of cut across romance a bit, wouldn't it? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. No, sir. Three bags full, sir. Poor lad. I don't think he wants to get married. I mean, when you really think about it, royalty has been inbreeding for centuries. I mean, if a Hereford was inbred that much, you'd leave it in a paddy by itself, wouldn't you? All sorts of things appear. Who knows? Who knows? That's right. I'm not saying against royalty. I'm just simply saying that inbreeding does tend to breed all sorts of things, doesn't it? I think it really is time for me to go. It was hours ago, but there's certain problems due to money. That's why I had to stay. So I'll see you on Friday, which is payday. I don't stay out late. Got no place to go. This is pretty pathetic, this tune. I'm home about eight, just me and my radio. A misbehaving, saving my love for you. The Fabulous Connolly at 0745. Well, it was exciting, wasn't it?
Wasn't that really wonderful? Really, really wonderful.